With our next talk, I give you Gaspar.
Hello.
Hello, Lua and my friends. I've come to talk with you again. Because a vision softly creeping left its seed while I was sleeping. And the vision that was planted in my mind still remains within the scope of Lua. Okay. So I'm really exhausted. I went out and all these Russian girls dancing around all night. Was very good, but so I'm a bit confused. I'll do my best. Okay, so Lubik is not a framework because I do not work in a frame. And actually, I don't even have an office. And I don't really know if I work. So framework is really a bad idea for what I'm doing. Anyway, so the idea behind this tool is that I've been creating shows, and I mean, I started in 1986, and I wrote code every single year doing stuff, and I've been like not reusing any of it. It's each time new and exciting, and then at the end I say, okay, the next step, I will build upon that, and then it's gonna be better, more and more, but I always end up restarting everything. So I thought, okay, let's try to do something so I can not reuse too much, and then, you know, all these dots and points and stuff. The idea also is that if you want other people to join in your team and they just don't understand your mess, it's not gonna work. So having documentation, having a little test, and maybe being able to do some live coding is nice because when you create a show, getting to the scene where there is this bug, where this square is really too big, or the light is really too low, or whatever, can take some steps, and then you have to set up stuff, and plug in the controller, and the sensor, and the whatever. And so sometimes it's nice to say, okay, wait, just don't move, and then, okay, looks better, we can continue. And this is really something that helps. So. And then stable is nice. So just a bit of history. The first prototype was in 2006 in Ruby. It was very funny. I tried to make music with it, and it was very rubato. You know, rubato is when you, instead of going pom 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 pom, you go pom 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 pom. So it's not very regular. And that's because the garbage collector would come in, come out, and a lot of stuff like that. It was funny. But it was not very useful because I had absolutely no control on the mess. The second prototype was a pure C++ thing. I thought, okay, I've got lots of events, sockets, and whatso. Let's use one OS thread for one thing. And so I had, like, I don't know, a lot of threads and mutex everywhere. And it was nice when it was not crashing. So there was a show with this thing, with people dancing. We were doing machine recognition and movement. It was so evolved that, for example, when a dancer was doing this, it would make a note like dong and ding. So it was really, I mean, super rocket science. But I mean, this is ridiculous. I mean, okay, bong and ding is really stupid, but nobody's doing better now. I mean, watch the shows with sensors. It's really awful. Anyway, then in 2011, I showed a third version at a Lua conference. I thought, okay, let's make it pure Lua. Let's get because, you know, with my C++ stuff, I was starting to create a variant type, and then a conversion system and stuff, and I thought, okay, this looks like a real language, but I'm very bad at creating a real language, so let's use one that's good. And I was already using Lua for state machines and things like that. So I said, OK, let's make it pure Lua. Let's get rid of all my mutex and threads and make something that works. So I created a show with this thing. The show was nice. It was not crashing. There was even a graphical interface that looked like something sexy. But the problem is that I don't have a screenshot of the actual one because I cannot launch it anymore for some obscure reason. But when you have just two objects and one line, it's really cool. But when you have a complete show running on this kind of abstraction, it's horrible. Really, you don't know what's going on where. It's very hard to just, you know, work on this part here while another guy works on the other part. So I said, okay, this is nice, but no. Also, I figured out that I was spending so much time making my graphical interface nice that I had no much time left for the rest. So I said, okay, let's just throw this away and start again. So this is the new version. As you see, it's much better than the old one because it's just scripts. And anyone can just jump in here and say, OK, what's this doing? There's like MIDI lens. I don't know what lens is. But then there's a run, so it might be a scheduler. And then there's this file watch. That's just for live coding. And then this is a MIDI input, and then there's a function that is probably called when it receives data. So if you have never seen what I'm doing, you look at this and you get some kind of idea, and then you run the script and you start coding in it, and then it auto-reloads, and that's just nice and it's enough. Okay, less is more. So I'm showing today the latest version that has modules. I also started to make Lua rocks and play nice with the community. So yeah, I'm working in this direction. So this is the whole stuff. The basic thing does class declaration. That's a bit my helper class. It's simple because everyone needs this little thing. There's template, mustache, and some algorithms and strings and so on. This one is not used in real time, but it's very important. It's the thing that's used for documentation. It's inline documentation. It supports literate programming, math, and there's also a testing framework with coverage and things like that. So this is documentation generated with a Documenter. So it's also based on Bootstrap from Twitter stuff. So it's responsive. That means it gets nice around if you have an iPad or a small screen, and that's kind of nice. It supports cross-references, so it detects every library code that you do in your example code and things like that, and you can click on it and jump around. And then supports math. These things here are actually LaTeX. So I think it's always nice that you can write a bit of LaTeX code in your comment, and then it shows up like this. It's done with math JAX, so you can copy-paste the code if you want. LaTeX is just not a nice thing to have. When you start to document your functions like this, you realize that you start to think differently too. You start to have a more precise way of defining what your function is doing. And this is something that is, I think, nice because, well, it makes you do a better job at what you're doing. This is literate programming, so you just write doc lit. That says, okay, this file you have to do literate programming. That means every comment should be taken out for as being documentation. So if you just, this is, I think it's Markdown, but I'm not sure. This is a title, this is a comment, and this is Lua code. So now if we look at what this gives, it's very close from the original file. It's just a bit nicer and made for web. Okay. Tests, for me, they should be simple and easy to read. I like the fact that you can read the function and say like it should merge or it should absolutize path. This is a bit like Ruby does with RSpec, and I found it nice. The assertions are assert equal, assert whatever. It's very well documented. There's also ranges for numerical imprecision, so you don't have to worry about many, many details to test a library with that. There are issues, like with every testing framework, for runtime systems, coroutine, SQL boundary. Sometimes the errors are not exactly what you have, but most of the time it's working good. So all the libraries are tested and documented. Not fully. I mean, the ones that are released are well tested and well documented. The ones that I'm working on are just sort of moving. The scheduler is very important. It's actually a combined thing with networking and scheduling, because these two things always work together. So I just said, okay, let's make a single library for both. This thing is very important for what I'm doing, and it's kind of special because you can start the scheduler in a terminal. So then on Mac you'll be using KQ or K-Events, or it's going to be Poll on Linux. And then you start a graphical interface, and the scheduler automatically moves into the main event loop, keeping the sockets and everything running. So it's also made to be asynchronous for everything. It uses coroutines for threads, and a sleep is just yield sleep with the time you want to sleep, for example. Socket wait is just yield read and the socket ID, socket number. I tried to, the C++ part in this library, I really tried to make it as efficient as possible. So, okay, this is something that for me is like the core part of my work. Timers, monotonic timers that don't drift if you have two for 1 week. This is like silly for other applications, but sometimes you create a project and it really runs for a week because it's in a gallery, and you should not just get into a mess after 2 minutes. And then there's this thing that listens for file system changes and that I use for code reloading, for example. These are some utility modules. They're just modules that you can install with LuaRock. YAML has a little bit a special thing in it. You can dump with sorted keys. This seem dumb like that, but if you do version tracking, it's very good to have sorted keys when you dump YAML. Okay, that's just so that each time you dump a file and you have the same Lua table at the origin, you get the same text file at the other end. And there's another little option in YAML that prevents loops in tables, because you know YAML has alias, so you can have a loop. So you can load a table that contains itself, that's recursive in YAML. So there's a little bit an option to prevent this, because you can have, well, it's like a security measure to make sure you don't end up in infinite loops in your code. This is just graphical types, vectors, matrices. It's a utility function for more advanced libraries so that they can communicate together, like physics, and so this is bullet physics. The bindings for bullet physics are what they need to be for me. They're not complete, they're easy to extend, so that's how it is. Media, this is video decoding and image decoding. It's using the fastest frameworks I can find around. Now it's decoding full HD at 60 frames per second. It's using OS 10 AV framework, so it's very parallelized, GPU optimized, and whatever. And that's a library that's wrapping OpenGL4. Typically, you have to transfer data between the physics world to the graphics world. That's why you have this log horrible name, but that's just for a utility graphics thing. Okay, Lui is the native UI, very simple. The idea was that I've been using Qt for a long time, and I'm always fighting these big projects, trying to compile them, trying to stay lightweight, trying to just keep up with what they're doing. And I thought, okay, I just want an OpenGL context and nothing more, just maybe mouse input and keyboard. And so this is LUI. So it's using native libraries. So there's no external dependency. On Mac, it's Cocoa. On Linux, it will be X11 probably. And so the idea is to have something very minimal for people who just need a window and OpenGL context. It integrates nicely with the scheduler. Well, that, of course, was one of my requirements. MIDI is just MIDI in and out. And then there's Dub. It's the C++ binding generator. So most of these libraries contain C++ code. And I wanted something that reads the headers and generates the bindings. So it uses Doxygen to read the headers. And it does a good job at creating the bindings. For an example, I just created Box2D bindings in like 2 hours and they worked. And the code between what you have in C++ and when you have it in Lua is very easy to translate. Basically, you replace an arrow with two dots and you have it. There's some tricks for garbage collections when you assign pointers and things like that, and callbacks and, you know, all these libraries are using Dub. OS support, it's like this on Windows. I mean, these slides are not interesting. This on Linux, this on Mac OS X. And what am I doing next? Well, nobody really cares. Yeah, there's something I need is parameters. So if you have a good idea on how, I mean, you know, in a script, I mean, especially if you're doing graphical things, sometimes you have to type 013 or 0135. And you know, this is like, sounds wrong to put all these numbers everywhere. And so it would be nice to have parameters, and then you can have like something with knobs and you go like that and it's very beautiful and you say, okay, I keep these parameters. Or maybe some sliders on a web page, you just go zip, 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 zip and your image is good. I don't know, I have to find something there, because for now I just type the numbers in the scripts and that looks kind of wrong. Immediate plans, nobody cares. And yeah, workshops, that would be nice. I think I want to do workshops someday to have people do stuff. Okay, I think that's my last slide or last something. So let's just do something else. Okay, so I'm a very, very powerful man, you know, because of Lua. Thank you. bébé en toi. J'ai cru que j'étais toi. Je ne savais rien de moi. Au début en toi. I took drugs to make pixel code, but then other things happened. Oh, with no idea what it is.
Thank you.
Will you publish the source code of this presentation?
I don't know. No. I have my little shader secrets there.
No. Okay, please take up the mic. Thank you.
Sorry, no, I won't publish the source code of the whole presentation because, yeah, well, it's part of my intimacy, this code, you know? And I'm not going naked with everyone for, I mean, there's some public stuff that's on GitHub, like everyone. And then there's some, you know, dirty secrets that just have to be seen but not understood.
Oh. So.
But I could show you that how live coding works, but like I have only one hand and it's always so slow, I won't.
I will hold the mic for you if you wish. We have 13 minutes.
Well, is it interesting?
Yeah.
Okay. Maybe I don't have to talk, you know.
Just mumble.
So we are actually running the last scene, which uses it should be spill floor. It's the spiral effect for the floor. So this is a vertex shader, fragment shader. This is Vim actually. So now we have color. I think it's this code that's showing this. So maybe if I just, well, I'll try. Color equal Victor 41001. So this should make the screen red. Oh, wow. No demo effect. Great. So now I can say, oh, cool, I can explore colors. Oh, wow, this is so cool. This is why I wanted to have, you know, parameters, so I could then turn to buttons and drop the screen, drop my textual brain, and just be into this feeling thing. Like the guy who created the chairs, you know, he entered this feeling thing and said, okay, blue, light, orange. Okay, so this is that. So for example, let's zoom on the thank you thing. So this is texture, and this is, I mean, if you don't know OpenGL, this is just a mess for you, but who cares? Oh, it's too small. Okay. You know, I'm stupid. Usually I don't know what I'm doing, but just do something and say, oh, that's the other way around. So this should make it big. Oh, it's too big, probably. It's just jumped out of the screen. Oh, yeah. You know, like that. So, okay. And then I could, you know, cheat with how it's mixing here. So, for example, so M is actually a uniform that is doing with a transition, how the things fuse together. So I can, you know, but this looks ridiculous. But actually, when you work like this, it's really fast and it's kind of funny and it keeps you in sort of playing mood and it's good for creative people like me. What I like with shaders like this is that it's totally unreadable once you've written them.
Show us some Lua then.
Well, Lua here is very simple. It's just declaring tables. An effect is just like that. For example, I can show you the code for a scene. So here, this is just singletons that load the different parts of the project. This means I use globals.
Oh.
But actually, they're hidden globals that you all use. It's the package global. Because once you require something, then it's always the same library, you know, that's loaded. So I do that by having inside my globals something that's called local self. The local self is something that you explore a lot when you do personal development. What is my local self? You wonder, you know, like you're in a place and there's your social self, but then there's your local self, the one that you keep just for yourself, but that sometimes you give to others. So that's exactly what we have here. if I have a local self, in this special situation, I can give myself to others.
That depends a lot on your environment.
Yeah, it depends on a lot if you're naked or not.
On environment only if it's Lua 5.2. Is it Lua 5.2?
I don't know. No, most of my libraries are all 5.1 and 5.2 compatible. But, you know, for me, a language is an idea, and I'm kind of tired of all these little, you know, like, this is my chair. I like the idea of Lua, and so it's Lua, okay? So who cares? So, for example, what was I saying? Okay, a scene. This is, like, it doesn't look like it, but the part where, is it too, no, it's big enough. This code to create scenes and transition with scenes with my remote here is very hard. I mean, for me, it took like 2006, and now we're in, well, it took like 8 years to get to the point where I could just think, okay, I'm going to have some libraries for my project and scenes, and I can load them. And when I load one scene, everything's plugged together correctly. And when I load the scene, it's at the beginning of the scene exactly how it should be. For example, if I change code here, it's going to reload and restart the third scene, which is that. And going there is just, for me, a huge victory. Because I can say, okay, now I want to work on scene one, and then it's loaded and it's working. I mean, I can say here, okay, let's go and drop everything down. So this, for example, the Wiimote code is, this is the transitions, movement of camera. It's just morphing between angles and positions. So the Wiimote, for example, this is where I say, okay, when I press A and it's on, this is what I do. Home on, this is what I do. This is like, thank you for having first order functions in Lua.
Thank you, Roberto.
No, I mean, this thing looks so easy to read and understand, and I can actually say, okay, when this thing gets hit, I'm gonna do fly mode. I'm just changing it here. Okay, so now when I press, I cannot put it on the ground anymore. So let's reverse it. Maybe I'm cheating on you. I mean, it didn't change. So I press the A button and it's falling, and now I press the home button and it's going up. And plus, 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 minus, 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 minus. And that's crazy, but hey, it's standing. Okay, anyway. So this is very nice because I'm walking through my scenes, tac, 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 tac. Oh, the wrong button. I just do this, tac, 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 three lines of code, and then it's right again. So yeah, well, it's a good way to work, really. I like it. So this is declaration. I don't know what this is. You know, okay. I think you have a global idea. Maybe you have the scenes here, the shaders here, some utility code there. That's why I was asking about multi-file stuff. But okay.
Is this a magic or engineering?
I think.
Or is this engineering of magic?
Yeah, I think so. Probably every ID is somehow magical, and when you manage to make it real, well, the frontier between engineering and magic is very hard to tell.
Yeah, I just wanted to make sure. So the idea is that you code a scene, and it gives you some freedom to express yourself when you run the show, right? So it's both you prepare a scene and you can. So how do you decide between what's in the scene, what's ready for you, and what you improvise on during the show, like plus plus minus minus? How do you decide? And what actually makes you? It's this variation. What drives you during the presentation so that you can.
Yeah, that's a very good question. I try to make the end project as open-ended as possible, and then I try to see what's coming from the energy of the people that are present. And so I really like tools that are open, that, you know, it's not like, and all tools I've tried that are used to create shows, they're always organized in a sequence, and they're, you start here, and then maybe there's this event, and then you go there, and you lack some freedom. So yes, it's very open. I really don't know what I'm doing until I'm on stage. It's just not a choice. I don't say, okay, this is free, this is not. I leave things open, and yeah, well, for example, here, the slides, I created them. They're stored as images. So that's something that was fixed. But then I'm not sure if I'm going to talk about them or not. You know, that's...
My question is inspired by his question. And I was looking at all the modules that that you presented, and there's lots of modules for graphics and interface, and there's MIDI in there. What about, especially in your performance that you just made, what about the audio? Was that a fixed soundtrack? I didn't think I see a... Okay, yeah. So you played the soundtrack for this one. And do you have modules for audio, with wave synthesis, something like that, or do you plan to?
No, not at all. I mean, maybe someday someone will have something, but I'm really an audio freak, and I mean, the level of what I'm waiting for from something that creates sound is so high that I have no way to get any way close to something that will sound good for me. And so there are so many tools, specialized tools that create so great, so good sounds, that we have OSC, for example, in this library. That's how I'm using this Wiimote. That I can so easily, you know, tweak parameters of real synthesizers with passionate people who spend years doing one thing that sounds like a real instrument and makes incredible sounds. That I think it's worth less. I mean, for example, Max MSP.
So you control actual hardware synths.
Software
using
synths.
Using MIDI.
Yeah, MIDI or OSC or
okay,
whatever fits the problem.
Right.
But the fact that you know, synthesizers are so good, and there's so many details that for me, it's out of range totally.
Yeah, so you don't get inspired to code your own sine waves and.
What might happen? For example, I have a friend. He's got playing drums, and he says, "Okay, I need to synchronize my drums with the loops." Then, okay, we will do machine learning with sound, but because that's fun and then that's useful and that's not existing. That's not something that you can do some other way. Then, we'll have a driver to get sound in, but, you know, not for real sound, more for detection or things like that.
I see, cool, thank you.
Thank you for a fascinating presentation. Maybe a naive question. Do you know about Russian traditional art, Ubuk? It sounds like your framework or your code base.
It's not related to demo scene or no. I don't know.
No, that's traditional art.
Okay,
traditional.
The drawings.
Okay. Yeah, drawings. Yeah.
No. Please show me later.
You could Google it.
Okay,
but Google it. You have 5 minutes.
I can show it. No, it's easy to find.
Just kidding.
Okay. There is something that when you do shader programming, you're playing with our visual hints. We're very good at analyzing what we see, and creating things like that is playing with these hints, making us feel there's movement, feel that there's transitions, feel that there's something and something. And this is something people have been doing in textile and in everything for thousands of years. And it's funny that you write some algorithm and then you get, oh, wow, this looks like an African tissue. And this is nice find. I mean, you go from very abstract mathematical things and you get to have something that your grandmother bought for you. So I like this fact, too, that, well, we're in one world. And we can get there with our special brains that are math oriented, but we still end up at the same place.
Hello, good show. My question: you tried to use Lua CV library, computer vision.
Yes, I did for a piece. I actually even tried to contribute the Lua bindings for OpenCV to CV source code a long time ago, but it was not stable enough, so it never really went to stable production. OpenCV is great, yes, of course. Depending on what you want to do. The problem with computer vision is that there's a huge latency. So if you want to have something that looks reactive, either you cheat or you use sensors, but vision is still very slow. Slow just to acquire the data to start working on it. That's why, for example, a lot of dance projects, the person is dancing, and the idea, for example, is to have things moving on the body, and it's very nice, but the dancer has to move like that, otherwise there's a shadow. And this is like, this, it's been like this for, what, 20 years, 15 years, and it has not advanced at all. So until we have really something that can get an image and have it fast into the GPU, for example, then I think it's something that is not very good for live arts, computer vision. It's good for image analysis, and okay. But then I also feel a lot of people are moving from OpenCV to GPU shaders. So then why just not write the shaders directly and, you know, like doing edge detection and feature detection that you can, there's pretty good code in pure OpenGL now. So I'm more moving in that direction because that's one dependency that's easy to manage. It's just a text of a shader, so yeah.
We have 5 more minutes and no questions, so do you have anything to fill them up? Or do you want coffee?
No, I can maybe just show you the video. Just an image.
Don't cheat.
Okay, so this is some images that I took near my home. And it's, I don't know how does it, do we see, well, we see that there's some screen sync issues that I have to resolve with how I swap OpenGL buffers. If you look at the center, you see that it's going like that. Okay, so this is actually running at, it's a full HD image. That's a very big image I took with my 6D Canon camera. I mean, it's a very big image. And it's taking, well, the CPU is low, the computer's not heating, and so I still have computing power to play with the image. I'm still very, very, it's okay. I don't want to code there. I want to buy a Linux computer, so I have to make the transition for a pure Linux computer so I can have a huge graphics card and really start to, for example, one of my dreams would be to use an image like that to create geometry and then to play with the geometry that this generates. And this means I must do feature detection, shape detection, maybe image, mapping, 3D mapping, stereo mapping from the image. Okay, so this was just video. I could code the video, but no, I don't have it here. Yes, it's here. That's how I start my shaders, just trying rhythms and frequencies. But okay, just, I have no more brain. I told you I was late yesterday dancing with incredible woman, so now I'm just.
Was it good? Was it worth it?
It was very good. The place was great. The people were playful.
Okay.
More than I want.
Thank you very much for the excellent presentation and excellent show. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.